It's time for MacBreak Weekly. It's a couple of days before MacWorld Expo, and we're going to add a preview for you with Paul Kent, the man who organizes this, the 27th annual MacWorld Expo. Coincides with the 27th birthday of the Macintosh. We'll talk about that, too, next on MacBreak Weekly.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for MacBreak Weekly is provided by Cachefly at cachefly.com.
This is MacBreak Weekly, episode 231, recorded January 25th, 2011. MacWorld Expo Preview. MacBreak Weekly is brought to you by FreshBooks, the easy online invoicing service that gets you paid quickly and makes you look professional. Get started with a free package at FreshBooks.com. And by Hover.com. Hover is domain name registration and management that's simple. For 10% off your new domain, go to MacBreak.hover.com. And by GoToMeeting. Reduce costs, improve efficiencies, and help your company's bottom line with GoToMeeting. For your free 30-day trial, visit GoToMeeting.com/MacBreak. It's the most wonderful time of the year. Welcome to MacBreak Weekly, MacWorld Expo Week. And you know what that means. The studio is jimmy-jammed with people in town for MacWorld Expo, including our good friend Don McAllister, who... That's not him. That's Adam Christiansen from Tidbits. Hey, Adam.
Well, that's the other Adam.
Oh, I'm sorry. Who are you?
I'm Adam Christiansen from the MacCast.
The MacCast. Oh, yeah. Adam Angst. Yeah, I got I'm Adam on a mind. I'm sorry about that. Yes, hi, it's Adam. Fine. I know who you are. I don't know what I'm saying.
Of course you do.
Good Lord. And then the Brit guy. No. I got my buttons on wrong. There he is, Don McAllister, who decided to come in.
Hi, Leo. Yes,
to
yes.
town on your way to Buenos Aires.
On the way, I thought I'd just stop in, you know, see MacWorld.
Is it on the way, really, to Buenos Aires?
No, not really.
Yeah, well. That's Alex Lindsay also here. We got a big show. And Andy Anako is on his way in. He's on Virgin America flying to San Francisco right now. Mm-hmm. And we're going to try to Skype him in from Virgin America because they got Wi-Fi. I don't think it'll work. But anyway, we're going to try. But before we go any further, we should say hello to the man behind MacWorld Expo for many years, Mr. Paul Kent. Hey, Paul.
Hi, Leo. How are you?
I am great. You must be crazy right about now.
It is hopping over here. I'm in my little office here at the Moscone, and all of the little ants are out there moving things here, there, setting things up. It's actually very cool. The building looks beautiful, and we're getting ready to host the big party this week.
When do you start preparing for the next MacWorld Expo?
You know, we work on MacWorld year-round, whether it's interviewing people to speak with us or out on sales calls trying to get new exhibitors to participate with us. So MacWorld is an ongoing concern for us. We work 365 on it.
So really, this is Christmas, New Year's, and April Fool's all rolled into one.
That's right. Hey, by the way, congratulations on the new facility. I saw the video yesterday. The brick Twit House is awesome.
Thank you, Paul. I appreciate it. Maybe, you know, we could have our own expo there.
It's like you got enough space.
Practically. MacWorld Expo will be coming to Moscone Center in San Francisco. The conference starts tomorrow, January 26th, and runs to the 29th. The expo itself is the 27th, 28th, and 29th at Moscone.
Now, Moscone West.
Moscone West. Moscone West. That's where Steve always gives his speeches. Oh,
I love Moscone West.
We take all three floors of Moscone West. The first floor is the expo. The second floor are the feature presentations. And the top floor are the conferences, which is pretty cool. Over in Moscone North and South, there's a laser conference over there. There's a lot of Dr. Evil jokes going over there.
Oh, lasers. Well, that's good. You know, we could get kill two birds with one stone, or so to speak. Maybe I shouldn't have. That was probably infelicitous. So, Paul, tell us a little bit about MacWorld Expo and what people who are coming to town can expect.
Absolutely. So, you know, this is our 27th year of presenting MacWorld.
Wow. Wait a minute. Let me let that sink in. 27 years.
Yeah.
So when was the first MacWorld Expo? It was 1984?
Well, I was three at the time, so I don't really remember it very well. So.
Oh, stop it. that's kind of hard to believe. Wow.
MacWorld was part of the launch activities for the original Mac. I mean, the launch of the trade show was, again, part of the the buzz building campaign when the original Mac came out, when we were fighting the evil empire of IBM.
Right, 1984. So 27 years later, in some ways, it's not really a Mac show anymore, is it? I mean, I guess there's Mac stuff there, but it's as much as iPhone and iPad show, I would imagine.
Absolutely. You know, MacWorld is kind of a mirror on the Apple products world. And so the show floor of MacWorld this year is actually very parallel to Apple's reported earnings. About a third of the show would be Mac-specific products, and about two-thirds are phone, pad, or pod products.
You know, it's funny how that's changed. I mean, you wouldn't, you know, 27 years ago, you wouldn't have said that. That's just amazing. Yeah. How many vendors this year?
About 260, so up about 10% from last year.
Hey, that's great.
Remember, yeah, we're really happy with that. I mean, again, the dynamics of the show have changed. One thing that's really interesting is about a third of the vendors are first time to MacWorld. And so that tells us a couple things. One, it's great for attendees because it's new blood. I think that's really exciting. Mm-hmm. Second thing is the way that people use a trade show has been changing. Rarely do companies use a trade show just to shake hands and keep in touch with customers anymore. Really, they either are a new company who's using MacWorld as a place to come to market, right, or they've got a new product to bring to market, and that's what they use the show for.
Well, that makes a lot of sense, actually. 2 years ago, Apple announced it wasn't coming back to MacWorld. Last year was your first non-Apple MacWorld, but you're growing, which is kind of interesting.
Yeah, actually, not only are we growing in exhibitors, we're growing dramatically with attendees. So, you know, I'm always cautious about sharing these types of numbers because the real number is how many people actually show up at right. the end of the show. But tracking things apples to apples, to coin a phrase, the number of pre-registrations we have is up dramatically from last year, about 25%. So if all things track the way they always have, we'll have close to 25,000 people here, which is up a lot over last year, and within shouting distance of the 26,000 we had the last show in 2009 when Apple did participate.
That's I'm glad to hear it, Paul.
People root for MacWorld. I mean, of course, everybody here is an Apple product lover, but people really like MacWorld. It is a reason. You know, last year you were so generous with us, you know, promoting the show, doing the keynote for us last year. MacWorld means something to people. It's still a place where people can get out of their houses, get out from behind their computers, and kind of face-to-face physically establish and reestablish the relationships that are so important to them.
There are some who say that important. People don't do that, but I think Mac people do it more than others. Let's put it that way.
Well, it's really users, too. I mean, I think that a lot of the conferences that I go to is all filled with professionals. You know, like, you know, that are a little
dated.
Well,
there's a professional track. I know there's a lot of pros there.
There's a lot of pros there, but what I think is really, what I find invigorating a lot of times is that there's a lot of users there.
There's
a lot of geeks there. That it's not, you know, it's people who are really into their Mac, that are really passionate and not quite as jaded as a lot of us are when we're walking around.
I like to say that MacWorld is one of the last populist technology events. You don't have to be an industry insider. It's not press only. It's not executives only. It's one of the few places where a user can buy a ticket, walk in, and discover products, take conference sessions for their own personal enjoyment. So it is a different vibe than many of the shows. And, you know, there's a lot of people who are kind of jaded conference professionals that are looking for different things. But the thing about MacWorld is that there's a joy quotient to it. There's just this great feeling that people come in. Everyone under the roof of Moscone has a common interest. And that creates all sorts of really interesting dynamics. Educators talking to musicians, filmmakers talking to musicians, just these kind of cross sections of users create a lot of really interesting things that is part of the vibe of what the show has always been about.
Do you get any contact from Apple at all? Do they talk to you at all? Or is it kind of, we're done, we don't want to have anything to do with you?
No, it's nothing that sinister. There's plenty of people at Apple who walk around the show because these are their customers too.
I fully expect Sal Segoyan will be right there front and center, of course.
Absolutely. Yeah. You know, and
the people we care about, let's put it that way, you know.
Right.
That's true. Yeah. I think that remember, these are all Apple's customers getting together in one place at one time, and it's an interesting dynamic and it's a lot of products. I heard last year that the store people walked the show looking for stuff to decide if they wanted to carry it or not.
Interesting.
So
yeah.
You know, this serves kind of they can't carry a flag for it, but I still think that this is a valuable thing for many pockets of Apple.
Yeah, it'd have to be. Do they, one of the things I always worry about is that Apple will undermine you by making an announcement shortly before or shortly after. Worse would be after. Do they communicate with you about that kind of stuff at all? Or?
Well, remember last year they announced the iPad a week before the show.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so what we did was we created an iPad special event where we had everybody, you know, Andy Anatko was a part of it, Jason Snell was a part of it.
That's right, I remember that, yeah.
And talked about. What is the iPad going to be? Is it a right. cool? And it actually added some of the energy to the show. You know, this year there's some energy about, you know, who's going over to Verizon. There's certainly, you know, if you think about all the really interesting and informed people that are at the show, you know, there's going to be conversation about Steve's health and will he return. There's going to be conversation about what the iPad 2 will be. And that's kind of one of the nice things. If you look at the show as kind of having this town hall feeling about it, you know, opinion shaping, informed opinion sharing, that all happens at a show like this. So whatever Apple does, you know, we want them to keep making great products. And then people come to MacWorld to learn about them, talk about them, feel connected in a different type of way than going into an Apple store is.
That's awesome. Well, Paul, I don't want to keep you because there's probably 18 people at your door going, Paul, we need you. So I'll let you go, but we'll see you. If you're going to the conference, you'll see him tomorrow. If you're there for the expo, it starts 10 a.m. Thursday at Moscone West. $45 for a ticket at the door. Is that right, Paul?
$25 until tomorrow, actually. So today it's $25.
So go now to MacWorldExpo.com and you can get your tickets right now and save $20. Also, it'll speed you up in the line, too.
That's
so
right.
Be a good thing to do. Thank you, Paul Kent.
Leo, thanks for having me on.
My pleasure. See you Thursday.
Looking forward to it.
Take care.
Bye-bye.
Paul Kent, who is, executive director, guy in charge, the boss of MacWorld
the dude.
Expo. The dude.
The dude.
And, you know, I have to think that it must be... It's a difficult job for Paul, especially with Apple leaving and everything.
It is, except what's great is that you're working on a product that keeps on growing. You know, Apple.
That's a shock to me, to be honest.
It's not a shock to me because the Apple market keeps on growing, because Apple's having one record quarter after another, there is still a lot of interest from the industry in that area, and that's not for a lot of the industries. They're stagnating, and Apple continues to grow. So I think that's the advantage.
Go ahead.
I think the big thing that came, and Paul said it, it's the enthusiasm of Apple users and Mac users that go to the show. You know, and you don't really see that in many other sort of conferences.
I was going to say, I can't think of a single platform conference anymore. I mean, Microsoft does conferences for developers, PDC, and they do WinHack for hardware, but those are very insidery conferences. You know, there used to be a Windows conference, a regular Windows conference, remember the Javits Center, that's long gone. So I think this is the last man standing on these solo platform conferences, you know?
Yeah, but I can't see it diminishing, though, because it's, you know, the enthusiasm for the Mac still keeps growing and
Yeah.
And as they bring out more and more new products, it's just going from strength to strength.
And sure, you'd like to see a Steve Jobs keynote, but who knows when we're going to see another Steve Jobs keynote anyway.
Right.
And in a way, Apple not being there kind of makes it all the more important, you know, in a way for the partisans.
I think it gives them a lot more freedom. It gives them... the ability to be a little bit more actually closer to the user.
It's true. Can you imagine the restrictions that Apple must have put on them and the difficulty of dealing with Apple all this time?
Paul's probably going. Everyone says that Apple's really, you know, just pretty laid back and anything goes. And
yeah, they're not control freaks. Adam, are you coming out?
I am. Yeah, I'm on Virgin tomorrow.
So good.
I'll be out there tomorrow.
Good.
Looking forward to it.
So, and look, you do MacCast. I see you every time, every year for the last decade at MacWorld Expo. You couldn't not go to MacWorld Expo.
Oh, no. And big part of it for me is the community show. And as far as it growing, I think that the Mac community is growing, or not just the Mac community, the Apple community. I'm getting a lot more people in my audience who are saying, you know, I got an iPhone or then I got an iPad and now I'm getting more into it. I found your show and I can't believe this community. So our community is growing with new users as Apple brings on products and new people.
Here's a question. Do you think that the Apple community is welcoming to newbies? Do you think that if...
Yeah, I know from my end we are and my show, it's really great because... there's people adding stuff. And one thing I like about getting new users in the community is I learn things. You know, I call myself the jaded. You know, we think we know all this stuff because we've learned over the years how to do certain things, but we also get set in our ways. And so I like it when new people come into the community, you kind of get new eyes on things and new perspectives. And so at a show like MacWorld, you know, when I go there, I'm going to meet these people and they kind of clue me in on things that I haven't really noticed. And I get smarter about Macs and Apple products and stuff like that when I'm there.
There's something about the Apple community that still, even though it's grown a lot and changed a lot.
Significantly.
There's something about, you still feel, people feel connected. Like if you have a Mac open in an airport.
Yeah.
Oftentimes a Mac user will just walk up and ask you something. Like they feel like I can talk to him.
Well, it's always going to be in a minority in that regard.
Yeah,
right?
Just be like, I can just walk over and have a conversation. One of my favorite things to do constantly.
It's a Mac thing.
It is a Mac
thing. You just wouldn't understand, no, right?
Yeah,
it's exactly. That kind of
it's a judgment attitude. Thing. I mean, I see people on TV, you know, getting interviewed, and then they pan down, there's a Mac, and they just go, oh, he's okay.
Yeah, that's interesting, isn't it?
He's all right.
But you're right.
Yeah, like if I see a PC, you know, and someone definitely on TV, I'm like, really? Or if yeah. In a movie.
Because you always see those Sony Vios. Well, you always see the Sony Vios because Sony makes the movie, right?
Right.
And you always know that person wouldn't be using a Sony Vio. Right. I just saw it the other day. I know that that person wouldn't be using a Vio.
Yeah.
Except for the fact that Sony produces a movie.
Right. Or I look at it and I go, well, that's going to be the bad guy.
Coming back to new users, though, the thing that really impresses me is, and there's always been the halo effect of the iPod, the original iPod, you know. But I think that was very limited. It sort of exposed people to Apple products, but, you know, it was...
iTunes on Windows was so god-awful that that didn't help.
It was a separate thing, you know, this little music player and a Mac, whereas now with the iPod Touch and with the iPad and
the iPhone... It's the phone is what it really is.
The halo effect has just exploded, you know, and it's actually bringing people, more and more people into, you know, the Mac as a...
Well, I think the new Airs are bringing a lot of people in, too. I mean, that's the 11-inch. I see the 11-inch in the airport everywhere.
I love the Air.
I was on one flight. I counted it, and I was coming back from the back of the plane. There were a
ton of iPads on the planes now, too.
18.
Yeah.
Airs? Airs.
Yeah. Wow.
Between the back of the plane and my seat.
More Airs than iPads, you think?
What? Oh, absolutely.
It's great for flying.
There are more out.
That's all I'm taking on the cruise.
I couldn't believe that. I kept on going, well, I'm just going to count. Because I noticed it on the way back. Mm-hmm. And as I was coming back up, I was like, I figured I'd count them.
Well, on the way over, I flew from Paris, and it was an 11-hour flight. I've got my 13-inch MacBook Air. And I thought, well, I'll do some work on the plane. We were only in coach, so limited legroom, etc.
And no power.
Yeah, and also, to be honest, the 13-inch was just a little bit too big for the coach seat.
Whereas 11?
Across the way, there was a guy with an 11-inch, and
guy
he
can
was
lean
away.
Back. Yeah. He could was practically keep it in your lap.
Yeah, it was unbelievable. Yeah. He even had his meal tray turned... He had his meal tray
okay, don't eat while you're computing. That's just rude. That's
but
rude.
It fitted in superbly. I was very jealous. Yeah. So I might have to get an 11-inch just for traveling. You know.
I couldn't be happier with the 11, I have to say. Do you think Mac owners are less smug? Somebody in the chat room, probably here for Windows Weekly, which was originally scheduled in this time, says, Mac users are smug. Do you think we're smug, Adam?
I don't, the answer is yes.
Just say it. Come on.
I don't like that word smug because I don't think I am. I mean,
you're not smug.
I programmed .NET and Windows machines, and I worked on both. And
I really wouldn't admit to that.
Especially in this day and age, it's less and less becoming that smugness is going away.
So that's old. You know. That's kind of an old impression.
I think so. I hope so. Maybe not.
Well, I think Mac owners were always like BMW owners. They were considered like the people who run the stop signs, the people who don't let you in and the highway, you know, that kind of smug.
I think it's
right?
Not so much smugness. I think, though, and this might sound smug by saying, but I don't intend it to. But Mac user, once you become a Mac user and you get it, you know, it's really getting it, understanding why the Mac is the platform that it is and why people enjoy it so much. And I think people can tend to get it, and then at that point, they either go completely overboard and start evangelizing about it,
right.
Or, you know, they then start to say, right, that's it now, Mac, and that's it no more.
Well, it's just hard. It's sometimes hard to understand. You know, like, why? You know, like when people...
Okay, we're just proving the point. I'm sorry. You're just digging it deeper.
So
come on.
There are definitely lots of applications. So I probably spend 30% of my time on a PC. Mm-hmm. So it's not like I'm not using that. But I use it for very specific applications. And a lot of times for me, when I look at people doing certain things on their PC and then banging their head on most of the experience. You know, my dad, every time I come home, there's something wrong with his PC. Like, there's something... That is seems simple, like the audio isn't working, mm-hmm. And even I can't figure it out. Like, I don't know what he did to get that, but without a reset of the system, I don't know what, you know, and it's like this deep well of unhappiness that I think that's the part where I think that's where the smugness comes from, is you just kind of go, oh, this is a lot harder than it has to be. Now, there's a lot of reasons to have it. I mean, for the PC stuff that I do, my graphics cards, for instance, work way... I mean, it's like lightning on the PC side of things. And so there's definitely things that I have to do on the PC, you know, and I love doing it there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think one of the things as well is the expense of a Mac. And it's very difficult to sort of relate to somebody why they should pay the extra premium for the computer.
That's what I have a hard time on the radio show with, is saying, you know, it's going to be 50% more. It is 50% more.
Yeah. I don't think it's time. I just value my time.
It's very difficult to, because if someone's coming from a PC background and they just use it as a utility and they're not really into computers, they just want something to do the
work. I can get this for half the price. Yeah, why should I buy this?
And you really can't, it's very difficult to actually put it across so that they wouldn't understand the concept of why you'd need to pay that premium.
I think that's why the iPad is gaining so much traction with, I think, new users and PC users. One, because of the price point. It's not the best. It's not a $300 Dell. But I think people can make the leap from, well, I'm going to get that $300 Dell and I'm going to struggle with it and all I'm doing is web and email and surfing. Well, the iPad can do that and I've eliminated all those sort of troubleshooting tech hassles.
I think the iPad's perfect for people who are using the web and checking their email and want to watch some videos here and there.
Yeah.
I think that unless it's Flash, of course.
Yeah. All right, let's take a break. I've got a great cast. Adam Christiansen is here. He is from the great Mac cast, kind of the original and still one of the best. I only say one of because I do one too. Macintosh podcasts.
There's a lot of great podcasts. Don and I are in the Mac Roundtable group, and
that's a good one too. Yes.
Yeah. So.
All right. Thank you, Adam. You're very generous. MacCast.com. How about that? Andy Anako may join us in a little bit from his airplane. If he comes on, I'll see him and I'll call him. But meanwhile, from the Pixel Corps, Alex Lindsay is here. Thanks to Alex for coming in a little early and talking about the new space. We're excited.
So excited.
We're going to occupy that. Probably you'll occupy it before we do.
We'll be building out. I mean, we'll occupy it at the same time. But yeah, I'll definitely have the. We're going to put up the big psych.
The big psych?
We're going to put, I think it's just going to be one wall.
It's not PSYCH. It's CYC.
CYC.
For a green screen.
Yeah, we're just going to put up one big wall with a cove. We're not going to put the corner cove in.
Are you going to do more mocap?
And we're going to have a 24 camera motion capture system.
24 cameras.
Remember back in the day, you did.
I thought I had a lot of cameras.
Yeah, it's 24 little tiny little cameras that we're going to put in there. Wow. And we can do it live and we're going to.
Doing a lot of great streaming, pixelcore.com, pixelcore.tv for the podcast. And we will, as you mentioned, you'll be a MacWorld Expo in force. So.
We are streaming like crazy. Yeah. So we're going to be streaming a couple hours a day starting at least on Friday, possibly on Thursday.
If you can't make it to the conference, just go to pixelcore.tv.
Yeah, we're going to be wandering around. So what we're going to do is we're going to have a live view following around the guys shooting the segments. So you'll get to kind of see and hear what they're shooting. And so you can definitely kind of follow along with us as we do that. We're also going to be streaming some 3D stuff from the just for fun.
Which is, by the way, why we're not going to be doing MacWorld Expo doing MacBreak there, because I just don't want to compete with this guy. Frankly,
how could you?
I know exactly, Adam. It's like, okay, 24 cameras, 3D. I don't know. I don't want to even go there. However, we will be doing iPad today. Sarah and I will be on the show floor, and we'll live stream that in the afternoon, 1:30 on Thursday, Pacific, 4:30 Eastern time. Also here, Don McAllister, who is on his way to Patagonia. Indeed. I just like saying that. From Screencasts Online.
Yeah, doing some sessions though in MacWorld. I'm speaking on Friday. I've got two sessions in the user conference.
What are you going to talk about?
I'm doing one session on ScreenFlow, which
I love ScreenFlow. Is that what you use for Screencasts Online?
Yeah, that's what I use for the initial capture.
Have you looked at Camtasia?
I have, but I've sort of used ScreenFlow since it first came out, so I'm sort of polarized.
Similar in features.
They're very similar.
I like some of the transitions and things.
The good thing is, though, it's a nice dual position now, so we'll get lots of developments in both applications.
Good. Yes, competition, always a good thing.
Camtasia, the great thing about the Camtasia is the tiny little file it makes. I feel like they made like a deal with the devil. You know, like how do you do that?
And it's the speed as well, the speed that they can write these files away.
Pretty amazing. Because you're capturing live motion on the screen, and so you're doing a lot of stuff in the background, and you can't slow down the live motion. It has to be.
But
so
only a couple years ago, we had like one option.
We used
on
Snap
Mac.
Z Pro.
And sometimes it would crash while it was recording, and there was all kinds of other stuff. And now it's like we have a plethora of choices, and both ScreenFlow and Camtasia are just fantastic.
I've used both, and I love both. And can I put in a plug for iMovie 11? Because that's what I was using. I just used that yesterday. I never edit video.
Yeah.
You know, I try to avoid it whenever possible. And it was just so easy and fun. Yeah. And I took the video was 1080p video from my 5D. Now I happen to have, an i7 Mac Pro. I mean, I don't know what it is. It's got eight processors in it. So it's with 8 gigs of RAM. So it's a pretty beefy machine. But it was just, couldn't have been sweeter to edit that video.
Long way in 10 years.
Yeah.
No 5 kidding. Years.
All right, we're going to get more, lots to talk about. Did you talk last week? I wasn't here. Thank you for filling in while
My
I was teaching Regis how to tweet. That's what I was doing during the show.
I saw.
You didn't see the Regis tweet stuff. That's coming up January 31st.
No, I saw you on the show.
I did the show, and then afterwards, with the car that I locked them into by accident. And then afterwards, we went upstairs to Regis's office, because next week on Live with Regis and Kelly is Twitter week. And they asked me to teach him how to tweet.
Oh, that's funny.
And I said, what do you want to tweet your first tweet? And he told me, and I said, okay, start typing it. And he said, okay, where's the I? So what do you mean? He didn't know how to type. And then so that took a long time. Fortunately, they're editing it down. And then I said, okay, good. Nice job. leave those errors in it. We really know it's you that way. And then I said, now click, tweet or whatever it says on the button. He said, click it. I said, yeah, the mouse. So he picks up the mouse, goes over to the screen. Ooh. And I thought, this is going to take a long time. We got him to do it. It was actually kind of neat because he saw his audience. He had announced that he was leaving the show that day. And he saw all the responses from his audience. And he was visibly moved. He got on the phone. He said, called his wife, Joy, go to this thing called Twitter. They're all talking to me. It was very interesting to see a guy who is the longest running. He's 80 years old. He's been on TV for 60 years. Longest running continuous television host in the world, England or the U.S. I'm sure in England they have no idea who Regis is. But he's been here for a long, long time with us. Get it.
Yeah.
Get it. Suddenly he goes, oh, they just said that. I said, yeah. So we took a picture. He says, I love my followers. And immediately the tweet started. And he's like, so there, I can talk to them. I said, yes. It was actually a great moment. It was really neat to see this old
and you shot the video,
guys. Yeah, it'll be on Monday, January 31st.
Awesome.
Hey, before we go on, did you talk last week about Steve? I guess it happened after the show. You did talk about him. Okay, so we don't have to belabor that.
We actually didn't belabor it very much. We kind of moved through it as fast as we could.
Yeah, we have lots more to talk about, including of the first Verizon iPhone ad, which we'll show you in just a second. Meanwhile, can I tell you about FreshBooks? I've been using FreshBooks since 2004. I found out Amber MacArthur told me about them. They're a Toronto-based company. And it was perfect timing for me because I was invoicing all my clients by hand I think I was probably using Word. And it was painful. And I couldn't keep track of who I owed money to and so forth. Along comes FreshBooks, and it changed my life. I want you to visit FreshBooks.com.
If you're an independent artist, if you're an independent if you don't have your people that are able to do that, you need to have people, because it really is not how much you make, it's when you make it. And the thing is, I've delayed invoicing someone by like a month or 2 months,
3 months.
Yeah, because I was like, oh, I got to make that invoice.
I
got to put that together. I got to do this stuff. And you just don't get around. This isn't what I got into the business to do, to send invoices. And so
FreshBooks makes it so easy. This is, you can go right now to FreshBooks.com and sign up. I'll give you all the features. I mean, for instance, there are a lot of clients who still want paper invoices. No problem. You push a button, it mails it to them. You can send them PDFs. They can pay online with FreshBooks, which is really cool. It really helps you get paid faster. They support PayPal and a lot of other online payment stuff. Salesforce.com plugin.
Wow, that's great.
Isn't that nice?
Yeah,
so you can do the CRM. Yep. Basically, FreshBooks is your accountant, is your bookkeeper online. It keeps track of your invoices. It ages them. There are 11 electronic payment services, actually a dozen. They can use your credit card. You can upload your company logo. So, I mean, that's what I did. My invoice looked so cool. It was me, and I had all the images and stuff, and I did this great invoice. But it was so fast and easy to do invoices. I knew which invoices were still outstanding. It made it just so easy to keep track of it. Now, if you go to FreshBooks.com, you enter the show code MacBreak, you will save big time. You could try it free for up to 3 clients. So, I mean, save. What do you need to save? It's free for 3 clients. For me, that was enough.
Yeah.
Take you about a minute. When they ask you how you heard about FreshBooks, make sure you say MacBreak, and here's your reward. Every day, FreshBooks is giving away a, quote, birthday cake to one of our audience members.
What if it's not your birthday?
It doesn't have to be your birthday.
You just get a cake.
You get a cake.
Happy birthday.
They'll draw a name every day for the entire month. they solved that problem because I thought, well, how can we do a, it's free for 3 clients, so what is the offer code going to give you? They say cake.
Let them eat cake.
Let them eat cake. I love it. Freshbooks.com. Give it a try. We know you'll like it, too. Now, let me push some buttons here because I want to play the... this is the Verizon... Have you seen the ad yet?
This is the two is better than one?
No, I haven't seen that one.
This is the...
this is the one for... Thank you for being so patient. Listen. Or watch. Or watch and listen. There are clocks. All clocks ticking. Waiting. By the way, notice he had a magic mouse. Yeah. Waiting.
To our millions of customers who never stopped believing this day would come. Thank you.
iPhone 4 Verizon. Now it begins. Now, you know what was, I thought very interesting about that is it was a very Apple ad, wasn't it? Doesn't it feel almost like 1984? It just, it had that feeling. I wonder if they got an Apple agency to produce it because it just...
Definitely had the feeling.
Didn't it?
Mm. Yeah.
So there's another one also after this? I didn't see another.
There was a two. The two is better than one.
It's an Apple. It's an Apple ad.
Is it an? I think it's the Apple ad for Verizon.
Yeah, it's the Apple. Apple came out right after this. I think the day after with their ad, which features both AT&T and Verizon.
Oh, interesting. Now here's an interesting question. iPhone 5, right? Sometime soon. I'm starting to. I just saw a little thing yesterday that kind of intimated that maybe it would be AT&T only. Is that possible?
I don't think so.
No.
In fact, if I was going to lay bets, I would say it's going to be on everything. You know, by the end of the year.
Well, that's the other question. You already got to see. Now you have CDMA and GSM. There's no reason not to be on Sprint and T-Mobile, right?
So the idea is you go across to all of them. I think that they have to do that to blunt, you know, more of the Android competition. Yeah. I think they just need to make sure that they're available everywhere. That exclusivity age, I think, is over for Apple.
And there are great pains to say that it wasn't an exclusivity deal with Verizon. You know, it was just a CDMA deal.
But I think what Verizon gets is they get the phone early. They get to get that jump on sales because, you know, I think I was trying to figure out why would they do this? Why would they release the iPhone 4 6 months before they're probably going to release the iPhone 5. And the only thing I could think of over the last 2 weeks was really that they're giving Verizon that advantage so that they can do whatever they're going to do. And then when they release the iPhone 5, I think it's going to have a dual chip. I think it's going to run on all the services. I think that, you know, or it definitely can.
Yeah.
All right. So let's do the happy dance. This is the... This is the two for one. iPhone on Verizon and AT&T.
They're going through a lot of trouble to say, it works the same.
It is exactly the same. Until a phone call comes in and you can't go to your data, never mind. Don't mention that fact.
That would be funny if AT&T did one just like this.
I love Ralph de la Vega. Not so much that Seidenberg fellow, but it's okay. You can FaceTime on both today. iPhone 4 on both.
Mm. Mm. It would be AT&T's response to that would be someone getting a call.
You know, like, that's what I'm saying.
Do the exact same ad, and then someone get a call and it goes, you know, that would be their response.
Somebody already edited a version where the AT&T phone, drops the internet connection.
Oh God, I gotta find that. That's got to be on here, right? Somewhere it's got to be. YouTube's got to have
on
that.
YouTube somewhere. Yeah, I just saw it this morning. Yeah, somebody edited it, and then I think they changed the tag at the end to say one is not the same or something like that.
Yeah, yeah.
Can't remember the tag.
I asked this last time, and I think that I'm going to start to agree with Andy, who said he didn't think a lot of people would switch to Verizon. This means nothing to you, no. Don, but. What, yeah. You had something to say? What?
Well, I don't know.
I don't think a lot of people run to Verizon.
I think people, it's really aimed at people who are on Verizon and have been waiting and waiting, which is what the first ad is all about. You know,
right.
They've been waiting and waiting and waiting. And those initial tranche of people will actually jump on it. But I don't think it's going to cause many people to actually switch over, especially with the iPhone 5 coming out, you know, in less than, you know, 6 months or so.
All right. Here's the edited thank you to the chat room. This is from 9 to 5 Mac. There's the original. Oh, no, I don't want the original. Oh, okay. This is the, I get it. This is the original cut, quote.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Let's see it. So there they are. They're all doing the same thing. And that, Safari cannot open the page because the address is invalid. The iPhone's not doing so well. Fly. Can't open page. System status is working. Now open a book. No book. I'm scrolling through the book and I'm doing all this stuff and it's frozen. That's AT&T. It sucks.
Ouch.
Ouch. But I still don't think, for all the hatred, and boy, there's a lot of hatred for AT&T. Do you, I guess because you're so connected with the American market, you know about this, Don. But
yeah, I can understand the sort of what's going on behind it. Yeah. I
mean, it's not that way in the UK.
Really, no, we don't sort of have the same sort of allegiances between the different carriers. You know, it's normally whoever offers the best deal. I mean, the coverage is, there's a slight difference between them, but it's such a small geographic area in the UK.
A lot easier to do, I guess.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So, yeah, we just go where the best deals are, really.
The service is so much better in the UK, too. I mean, and in Europe and in Japan. And, I mean, that's the big thing, is I notice on my iPhone in these other countries.
It's because America is a great land. It is a spread out land. I got Australians in here, I got Brits in here, but it's because America is stretched. There's a lot of area.
The funny
right?
thing, though, is that the places that it doesn't work is not where it's stretched out. It's the places that it doesn't work is where there's lots of buildings and lots of, and this gets back into, you know, Verizon's core advantage, which we talked about a bit last week, is that the CDMA is a much more robust system. No one uses it, you know, or not many people use it, but it's a much more robust system to keep a signal, and so they don't have to put up as many towers, and that's a big issue in New York and San Francisco where real estate is so expensive and difficult. It's difficult to get buildings to let you put stuff on them, and that's the big challenge in New York and San Francisco, which is where all the press is, which is why part of why they build all that up.
Another big thing with the CDMA, though, is it's a global impact.
That's the true power of the press, by the way.
Yeah, exactly. We can get cell phone towers.
There's untapped markets in India and China that use the CDMA network, and that's where they can roll it out into in those territories as well. Yeah. But is it true that there's areas in the UK, sorry, in the UK, in the US, where there is no AT&T coverage at all?
Oh, yeah. People, New Hampshire. Right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Julie. Yeah.
Julie says where do you live, Julie?
Fargo,
North Dakota.
Wow.
So you're always handcuffed.
No AT&T. So
according
to
AT&T, 3% of the market.
What do you use? Yeah.
You live in Verizon.
Verizon. Yeah. Verizon. So are you going to get a Verizon iPhone, Julie? The day it comes out, she says.
My wife's going back. She's a switcher.
Your wife is a switcher.
She's going to switch.
So this
back.
Is the question, is are people going to switch? So,
and here's the decision process for my wife, is that she doesn't care about having the newest phone. Mm-hmm. So she doesn't care about whether the iPhone 5 is coming out or not. She wants just to go back to Verizon because she doesn't like AT&T. So I think this is where they're going to see a million, maybe 2 million sales, is that she just wants to go back to Verizon. She'll keep this phone for another 2 or 3 years. It doesn't really matter to her that the iPhone 5 is a little bit faster, you know, and that's, you know, she loves the iPhone, but she doesn't.
I'm going to ask, because we have such an esteemed panel, Adam Christiansen, Don McAllister, Andy Anatko, maybe on this plane, and Alex Lindsay. I'm going to ask you about iPhone 5 in just a second, but we do have one other story about the iPhone. I should mention, Verizon has now said they're going to drop their limited data plan. They will only do one plan for $30 of, quote,
what does that mean?
Limited, unlimited. Well, I think all of them say limit. In fact, Virgin Mobile, which had this unlimited plan, is now sending out emails saying, well, if you go over 5 gigabytes, we're going to slow you down. May not charge you, but we're going to slow you down. I know there's no way unlimited is truly unlimited on any platform, right? So, but this is Verizon. So what does that mean? Verizon saying, they also say they will give a $200 Visa card for some customers, current customers who upgrade. They dropped their new every two promotion right before the iPhone. That's really annoying. But they, if you purchased a new smartphone, feature phone, or certified pre-owned phone, basically any phone, from the end of November to the beginning of January, you will get some money back, because you bought that phone just before the Verizon iPhone announcement. November 26th through January 10th, you'll be eligible to get $200 back on a Visa gift card. But you have to buy the iPhone 4 at full retail and return the existing phone. I think that's okay. Is that what you're going to do, Julie? Is that how you're going to do it? She was nodding. That's like she knew. Yeah, that's how you're going to do it. What do you have right now? A droid. And you're going to turn in your... Oh, Aris is kind of old, though. Yeah. All right.
But I will say that then you have to go to the store, too. I mean, I will say I bought both at the AT&T store and at the Apple store.
Yeah.
And it's one little thing, and I have to admit, the price is the same, except that when I buy it at the AT&T store, I have to go through all the manual stuff of getting my AppleCare hooked up. And where I have, when I just go to the Apple store, when you buy it, it's all done. And I have to admit, it's faster.
Why do you do Apple Care? What's what? I don't
Apple
understand.
Care. Yeah. If you used Apple Care as often as I did,
you use it a lot.
Oh my gosh! I think I run my hardware pretty hard, and I think that about half of my machines end up
really
at some point in time.
All right.
You know, I mean, I just beat them up, and then I bring them in. My kids beat them up and bring them in, and it's great to know that they can just you can replace the power supply or you can replace the whatever. You know, we had one issue where there's something wrong with our power at our house, and they just kept on killing power supplies one after another. And we just kept on taking them to the Apple store, you know, and that paid off that Apple, you know, that, you know, because it just was blowing them out every 2 weeks. It was
killing them. They're pretty generous. You know, my daughter,
really easygoing.
I bought my daughter an iPhone while she was home for Christmas. She's at college, and she dropped it and broke within 2 weeks. I said, oh, crud. And I was going to get, the iPhone repair people up here in Roanoke Park, and it's $125 for a new screen. She said, well, let me bring it to the Apple store. She did, and they replaced it. She said, oh, I just bought this. And it was her fault. She dropped it. They replaced it.
And I have to admit, what I do is I build up, like, so I have a laptop that's 2.5 years old, and it's got a bunch of weird little things that aren't working with it. And what I'll do is at 2.5 years, I'll take it in and say, this is the whole list of things that I want to make it almost
new again. And
they
just do it.
And they just kind of, you know, a lot of times I'll just kind of build up and then hand it to them, and then comes back all.
So you're really abusing it, basically.
It's like wear and tear. It's not like I'm breaking it or dropping it. It's just that the trackpad doesn't work as well.
But is Apple Care really designed to take care of wear and tear? That's why
you get it. Yeah, I mean, if things are breaking that I didn't drop it, and you know, they gave me 3 years as far as I'm concerned. You know, it's like now 3 years for me is like dog years. You know, so it's but.
I think if you've got a laptop, especially though, that's where it comes into its own with display problems and hinges and things. And
it just takes so much stress out of it. We buy every computer
I never buy Apple.
Oh, I always get Apple Care because it just takes the thing. Here's the deal: is we've had enough problems. I mean, we've probably bought 60 computers in the last three or four years. You know, so we had enough problems with enough individual ones that paid off all the money we put into Apple Care. You know, because of bad motherboards or bad, and usually it's after the first year the things start to wear and tear. So,
I think the Apple Store people are pretty nice. I did not buy Abby Apple Care. I don't think for that phone.
Oh, really?
Still replaced it. Yeah, I think they're pretty nice in general.
Yeah. Oh no, it's great service. It's fast.
It's a nice little profit center for Apple, so I'm all for it.
If I didn't feel like I was winning on my I wouldn't get do it. I'm pretty.
Well, you're winning, all right.
The only
thing I would say about Apple Care though is make sure you get it from a proper dealer, either from an Apple dealer.
Don't buy that Best Buy crap.
Well, I don't know about that, but I bought some off eBay once. And
you can't buy Apple Care on eBay.
Yeah, eBay and Amazon, you can get it Apple Care as well. And I've heard reports even of people who bought Apple Care off Amazon sort of having to prove.
Oh, really? Buy it from Apple. In other words.
Yeah. So
because then you're in the database.
Apple or Apple resellers. Yeah, you have to buy it from.
And then there are AT&T that will sell a maintenance schedule on an iPhone. But I asked him, I wouldn't buy that.
My whole thing is I've just gotten after I bought them from. I bought them from lots of different stores. I bought computers from Amazon. I bought iPhones from AT&T.
To go to the Apple Store.
Just go to the Apple Store and buy it. I know they hate me saying that, but it's just not worth the trouble.
You're lucky, though. I mean, you have an Apple Store nearby.
There's one. Everybody has an Apple Store nearby.
Is that true?
Click.
Oh,
it's like
you mean
I go
online.
Up to the internet and then I click on. If you know you want an iPhone, why go to the store? I mean, you know, it's like if you know what computer you want. I mean, if you want to touch it, it's fine. But
no, that's how I got my iPhone. Yeah, and they deliver it day of, which is nice.
It's just I can't.
Are you going to buy an iPhone 5 the minute it comes out?
Me?
Yes.
Of course.
Yeah.
You too.
It's your job, isn't it?
It's my job.
Yeah.
You too.
You know, I'm taking one for the team. You know,
Adam. You too.
Yeah. I'll be getting one.
But we're not accurate.
My wife's excited because she said to me this morning, she said, then I'll get, are you going to get a new iPhone when it comes out? When's it coming out? And I said, well, probably June. She said, good, because then I can get an iPhone 4, meaning my current one.
She's smart. Yeah. She's frugal.
Exactly.
All right, let's talk about the iPhone 5 and what it might be in just a little bit. Before we do, though, I want to talk a little bit about hover.com. It's a great place to register your domains. And I'll tell you how you can save 10% in just a bit. Hover makes it simple, makes it clean. I'm getting more and more tweets from people who are moving from those other guys saying, wow, I had no idea it could be this easy and simple and straightforward. And you know what? Just I want to say the word clean. Just go to, if you go to macbreak.hover.com right now, I want to type that in here, macbreak.hover.com. It's immediately apparent that this is something a little bit different. A little simpler, a little cleaner. You could search for a domain. If you're going to transfer a domain, that's what we did. We transferred a bunch of domains. click the transfer your domain button. It's very straightforward. Well, if your ex-registrar makes it straightforward. Do notice that they have it for $25, no matter how many domains you're transferring, they'll do it all for you. And I think that's worth it. I wish I'd done that. I'm still in locked domain hell.
Ugh.
I hate that.
That's all I got to say.
But we're moving them all
for the
over.
First time last.
What'd you think?
About 3 weeks ago, I transferred the domain name across from one of those people.
Yeah.
To Harvard. Actually, it worked very well. It was very simple. It was, in fact, over the Christmas week, so I was a little bit nervous about delays, but it only took about 3 or 4 days for it to all go through. Yeah, it was great.
Yep. And prices start at, if you're just doing domain forwarding, $15, but they also will do email if you want custom URLs and so forth. But they don't do a lot of upsell. And one of the things I really like, those other guys will charge you a significant amount of money for domain privacy. I don't like people to know, you know, normally on your domain name, you've got your phone number and your address, and I don't want that. So Hover, it's automatic. Every domain has domain privacy automatically. That's part of the price. And their new no-hold policy for customer service calls Monday through Friday, 9 a.m. to 8 p.m. Eastern time means you will never be put on hold. Once you get a live person, that person will fix your issue, and you'll never get put on hold. So I want you to go right now. You can use Hover's domain management to set up email addresses, forward email addresses, redirect your domain to other websites, create URL extensions, set privacy controls, all with fewer clicks and without the upsell. Hover.com. I want you to go to MacBreak.hover.com. And on checkout, use the offer code MacBreak. You will save 10% right up front. That's a nice deal. We love Hover. The old domains direct. If you say, who was Hover? I never heard of it's Two Cows, Domains Direct, and they just decided to rebrand it. And I think it's a great service, and I'm really happy to be moving all my domains over there. So iPhone 5, Adam, you think June?
Yeah, I think Apple's on their yearly release cycle, and I think they're going to stick to that. And it's going to be shocking, I think, to the Verizon people.
Well, that's what I was wondering. I mean, you know, in fact, that's what I've been saying to people is, if you are a Verizon person and you're switching, just think how you're going to feel. Just kind of put yourself in that position. How's it going to be when the new 5 comes out in 4 months? You can live with that, Julia? Yeah, she said, I don't care. I got to get a phone. Anything to not have to use a Droid Eris.
See, only those people who would know, in fact, that there's an iPhone 5 most likely coming out in the summer. And those people who aren't really interested in the next greatest phone, they'll just get it now and just get it.
That's most people, right? It's only us that really says, oh, I have to get it. So what is going to be in the iPhone 5 that's going to make it so good? I don't think it's going to have a higher res screen that would add too much to the price.
I don't think it's going to add a higher res screen. The dual processor, I think, is probably likely.
Yeah, everybody's going dual.
Yeah,
there'll be an A5, right, which will have the Cortex, the ARM 9.
There'll be a USB micro in there because it has to be.
Oh, for Europe.
Yep.
Thank God.
Well, it depends on what kind of feature functionality they give it, but
well, it should have all the functionality, right? I mean, it's just a data port.
Well, it'll have power.
You don't need
the
pins.
Reason they're doing it is for power, right? So that's the.
Oh, you think that they might if they're abandon, will they abandon the 30-pin connector or will they have it as well?
I think they'll have it.
I think
because that's a revenue stream for them as well, isn't it? Because they can license connections using the 30-pin connector, so they're not going to give that up. So probably be both.
So cynical. You're so cynical. You think Apple cares more about money than they do about us as users?
It's all about managing the quality of experience.
Come on, you're such a cynic.
They're not a charity, are they?
I think they're not. It would be good. I mean, I'm a little bummed about the micro USB because it's such an unstable connection. I mean, the mini USB was the last one. I mean, once you go to micro, they don't stay in as well. They don't.
I had lots of issues with cables.
Yeah.
I mean, I use it for like the Mophie to charge the Mophie, and one cable will charge and also sync. One cable will just charge it.
That's why actually I got the Miley was specifically because it had a mini. I literally went to the store and looked at it and I was like, oh, we got a mini pin here. I'm just going to use the mini because I don't want to go to micro because I've had so much trouble with my MiFi, with anything that's got micro USB. I have been beaten.
Big rumor on Bloomberg today that near field communications, NFC, will be built into the iPhone. Now, I have NFC in my Google Nexus S, and I can tell you right now, I can't use it. Nobody uses it. What are they talking about? But the idea is this is like kind of like Bluetooth, except it's within a foot or less. You hold it, so I can go to McDonald's, right? And I wave my magic phone, and then they give me food.
You can now buy Starbucks. You can go to Starbucks and buy coffee with your
iPhone.
But
it's a barcode, so you have to put it up on the screen. And I don't think in the States are people in the UK using NFC?
Not that I'm aware of. No.
But if Apple does, if Apple puts it in tens of millions of iPhone 4s or 5s, I'm sorry. Presumably that would.
Well, my question is that
forward this, right?
I'm curious as to whether that's compatible with like the technologies we see at BART and so on and so forth. You know, that they've gotten into with the cards.
Those probably, I don't know. I think they are.
If it is, it'd be great to be.
Visa is using it with their PayWave. I would bet, you know, it's very similar to RFID, but it's not RFID. It's a near field RFID, I guess.
It's something they've had in Japan for quite a while, isn't it? This sort of technology.
Is that what the Pasmo works with?
Possibly, yeah. Okay.
So if they build, so that would be an interesting thing to build in. So we got faster processor, NFC. You know, Google's kind of in the, you know, wandering in the wilderness with this Nexus S. Nobody else uses it, but if everybody uses it, that's good news. What else?
Voice possibly, because they did the Siri. Was it Siri, the application they bought?
Yeah.
I mean, because they have started with the voice control.
I use that all the time on the Nexus S. I will press the button and say send text, and then to Don McAllister message. Yo yo yo, what's up? And it does everything except the yo yo yo. I don't know why, but that's really nice to be able to do that. And I would love to see that.
Yeah, so they've started.
It's more than voice control. They already have voice control. This is like dictating messages, stuff like that. Siri was very smart. You could book restaurants and things.
Yeah, see, we never were able to use that in the UK. I think it was on the US service.
You could say book me a table for two at E Fratelli, and it would if you know use OpenTable, it would know. There was some sort of interface. You could say, add a calendar appointment. We had a lot of artificial intelligence. Do you use Siri, Adam?
I played around with it when it first came out. And then after kind of Apple bought it, I didn't really use it too much. I don't do that a lot on my phone, I guess.
I think people, it was like texting. Remember? I don't know if anybody remembers, but we didn't text in the U.S. about 5 years ago. Nobody texted. And then, because there were a number of historical
reasons.
They
charged us a lot for it. That was one of the big
things.
And
there was cross-platform stuff. But when it happened, it happened. I mean, everybody got used to it. Now everybody is very routine. Everybody texts. Yeah. And I would guess this is like that, that once you get used to talking to your phone, maybe you would use it more. But you have to get in the habit.
I think you like it. Go ahead.
If it worked better, I guess. I try and use just the voice stuff to, like, call people. And so I guess if they can do a better job of it, if they got those Siri engineers on board at Apple and they've improved it. But my biggest dilemma with it was I'd say, call Leo, and it would say, calling Alex.
Yeah.
No.
It's terrible because I say, call Tom, and then I call my mom, and mom's on. Hi, Mom. Yeah.
It gets me in trouble because it doesn't know who my wife is. I say, call Carlita, and it always calls Cowie Lewis. I mean, you know, it's like, you know, and it was like, you know, it's like, it starts ringing. I was like, no, turn it off.
It's a Freudian iPhone.
And you can't say cancel to the thing. That's my biggest thing is you cannot say cancel. You have to touch the screen or whatever. I can't
call
remember.
My imaginary wife, Callie Lewis.
Happy birthday, Callie, by the way. It's her birthday today. Not germane, but I just thought I'd mention it since you mentioned it. What else? What else in the iPhone?
I think that the iPad is going to be the big jump.
You think that'll have a high res screen?
I think we're going to have a higher res screen. It's not going to be at the same detail.
Too expensive.
The thing is that would be a retina screen at that size would be a higher resolution than the 27-inch iMac. I mean, it would, or very close to that. And you're just talking about processing.
Cool.
You know,
I want it.
I could see Apple going to 1920 by 1080
I think
what they should do is 1280 by 720 or 1280 by 800. I don't think that they need to go any higher than that.
I think people are going to be a little disappointed when the iPad 2 just has a camera. And
dual process camera.
You know, if they go A5 across the board, that would be a big deal. I played with a number of the Tegra 2 stuff at CES, and it's fast. Of course, Tegra 2 has a GeForce GPU in there. We don't know what Apple would put into its A5 in terms of a GPU, but presumably be comparable. That would be pretty sweet.
But I think going to that higher. I mean, I think that could be the thing that a lot of these Android are going to higher resolution. I think Apple might want to compete with them. Especially since they have the quote-unquote Retina display that they're kind of bragging about.
So the thing that puzzles me though is why they would want to do it, other than for going up against competition. Because really, the current screen is fantastic for watching movies or
for watching movies. I meant reading though. It that's where it makes a difference. If you really look at the iPad as something I can read, I think that then you're tempted to want at least have a little bit more. Yeah,
the only bit where it does have a major failing at that resolution is using folders, the small icons within the folders on the home screen, because they do look very granular and very grainy and very difficult to make out. So that would be
And they look so good on the iPhone. You can actually read them. Yeah. You can see that there's a little teeny weeny angry bird right in there.
Well, whether or not they'd want to go to the expense and the trouble of re-engineering just for that sort of level.
Yeah, I think they might. So it'll be interesting to see how that goes. But I think that
when will they announce the iPad 2?
March.
When they're ready to release it.
That's a cop-out.
No, seriously, because, I mean, last year they announced it, two or three months in advance. They don't want to release
it. They don't need to do that this time.
They don't need to pre-announce it this time because it would hit sales. So as soon as it's ready to go. So, March or April.
When did they release it? April?
I think there's a pattern. April, wasn't it? Yeah. I think there's a pattern we're seeing, and I think we're going to continue to see it.
Yearly.
You're going to get an iPad in the spring. You're going to get an iPhone in the summer. You're going to get something with iTunes in the fall. And then we'll quietly sprinkle about other hardware.
I think that's good. I think that Apple is looking at what's happening in the Android market with a new handset every 2 weeks and realizing that scares the hell out of people and makes it very difficult to keep up to date. And I think they're saying, if we want our users to know when the updates are. We want them to know it's April, June, September, April, June, September. That's a good thing, right?
And for newbies, I don't think a lot of people don't care. I mean, when they're just getting into it, the people who just walk into the store and buy it, they're getting all those sales because people just want it. They won't
advertise it because they don't want newbies to know.
But for
those of us in the know.
Well, there's probably 20. I think there's probably 20. I'm going to guess 20% of iPhone users buy one every year. I mean, that's part of what they push. Every year.
100% of the people in this room.
We're not an accurate cross sample of the general population.
Oh, I don't know.
Yeah. Apple has made a good cycle for their revenue though too. I mean, it's going to stay nice and steady with that release cycle, and I think they probably like that also.
So Apple announces, we were watching the ticker go for the 10 billionth app clicked over. They sold their 10 billionth app. It was that paper airplane, the paper toss where you throw the crumpled up piece of paper in the, it was free. Bump, remember Bump was like the one, what was it, 1 millionth or whatever it was. 10 billionth. So it's a woman in the UK. Do you know her?
No. I wish I did.
Because, I thought maybe you might know her because she lives there.
No. There's this small little village.
Yeah. She lives in your little village. Apple calls her. She hangs up. She thinks it's a prank.
I think it was for her daughter, right? I think her daughter bought it. And then
she didn't know she bought it.
Right. And she was just like,
I didn't buy that. Go away.
Oh, not with the accents. Go.
Well, what does it sound like in Orpington? What is an Orpington accent?
Orpington, that's Kent, I think, Orpington, isn't it? Yeah. So it's a southern accent.
Oh, I don't know that. You're a northerner.
Yeah, I'm a northerner. I'm Scouser.
She said, thank you very much. I'm not interested. Now, that's northern.
Yeah.
The only problem was the caller was really someone from Apple, and Davis really had won a prize. It was, in fact, $10,000 or something like that, right? Paper Glider. That's the 10 billionth app.
That's a UK app as well, I think.
It wasn't Paper Toss. It was Paper Glider. Mm-hmm. How far can you flick and fly your paper plane? It's a copy of Paper Toss. She called Apple back and was distraught because she called the help desk and the woman said, well, I don't know what you're talking about. Get out of here. So she got a $10,000 gift card.
See, I can understand doing that because we do get, I don't know if it's the same in the States, but we do get lots of cold calls from people saying you've won, a cruise for the Caribbean and stuff like that. So nine times out of 10, people will just put the phone down.
Me too. We get that too. Yeah. She says, the more I thought about it, the more I realized it was a genuine call. The girls were getting quite tense. They would never have forgiven me. They would have held against me for all eternity. $10,000 worth of free apps. That's pretty good.
That's a lot of Angry Birds.
Yeah.
That is a lot.
It's a lot of eagles.
You could buy an iPod or something, or iPod Touch or something with that.
Angry Eagles.
But you can't.
No. You can't?
I don't think you can.
You can
only
buy apps.
I think it's just apps.
Oh, that sucks.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
You can have every app,
she could buy a Mac Pro with a 30-inch screen.
Yeah.
And an Angry Birds.
But I think all she can
buy is apps. She might have enough left over for the Angry Birds.
Now, we didn't talk last week because it came out afterwards is that Apple made some money. It turned out that they didn't lose any money. I know we were worried about it. We thought that they would.
Oh, we didn't think they'd lose money. Come on. Really?
Yeah.
So what were the quarterly results?
I think it was 20. I want to say 26.7 billion for the quarter.
Oh, chump change.
You know, I think I calculated it out at $100,000. I want to say $100,000 a minute.
Mm.
I believe that was about it.
It was really
something like that. Yeah,
Good Lord.
I was playing around with the you know, they were just kind of the printing presses in One Cupertino, the new ones, are fully operational.
That's what I'm gonna do with our basement. We're gonna have printing presses down there. I was just thinking what I could do in We Rule with $10,000 worth of mojo. 16.24 million iPhones, 7.33 million iPads in one quarter.
Right. I had said 8.6 million in all of last year, and they did almost that in one quarter.
4.13 million Macs. So they're selling four times more iPhones than Macs, twice as many iPads as Macs. They sold 19.5 million iPods. That's actually, in unit sales, that's the biggest is iPod. Which, that surprises me, that they're still selling iPods.
My parents love their little Nano.
Well, someone said that the iPod Touch, the sales was like a $2 billion industry on its own. They sold $2 billion.
The Touch is pretty cool. So if you don't have to get the contract, I've bought Touches for people. In fact, I bought two Touches
for
Christmas.
Can you FaceTime someone with a Touch?
On Wi-Fi, yeah.
On Wi-Fi.
The new one.
Yeah, you have to have the front-facing camera. Those are pretty good. 26 and three-quarter billion American billions.
Well, not, and this was not the, UK here's the interesting billions. Thing is this is the biggest by unit sales, I believe, the highest sales of Macs themselves. So while they were smaller than iPods,
isn't that interesting?
But it was
the
actually
Mac is not dead.
They sold more Macs in the last quarter than they've ever sold before.
So revenue of $26,000 million. Does that feel better to you if I say that? $26,000 million and a record net quarterly profit of $3,000 million. That just sounds wrong. Wow, is that how you say it though? $3,000 million.
$3,000 million?
Yeah, that's three billion.
When I check my bank account, that's what.
$3,000 million. It sounds like more. $3,000 million does sound like more than $3 billion.
Oh, we use billion. No, we use billion.
But your billion is more than $1,000 million.
Yeah. Oh. I never really have to worry about that too much.
A UK billion is $1,000 millions.
Right.
Which, if I were a billionaire in the UK, now that's rich.
Mm-hmm.
It's only 1,000. I'm confused. It's a gazillion.
The big question is
23% increase in Mac sales quarter to quarter, year to year.
The big question is whether Apple can bypass Exxon this year.
Oh, I don't know. You keep bringing that up like that matters.
I just
anybody.
Think it's cool. That's all. I just think it's it's absurd. That's why I think it's the reason I'm fascinated by it is just that I think it's so absurd that Apple would pass an oil company.
Yeah. Yeah, that's pretty amazing.
It's kind of like pigs and flying.
But that's just stock. That's just stock.
It's stock. Yeah, that's the one thing to remember is that there's...
It doesn't mean anything.
Is that this is nothing
to do with
revenue.
They're not bigger in revenue.
No, no, no. And Apple's much smaller when it comes to revenue than many, many companies, including Microsoft, you know.
I think the big factor, though, for that last quarter for Macs is the MacBook Air. You know, that must have had a huge impact.
Do we know? Did they break it down?
I'm not sure if they actually gave us the actual figures.
I'd love
to
know.
They did mention that it was a strong, a strong impact on the sales. And that's only going to be carried forward, into the
community. Isn't it interesting? I mean, the original MacBook Air, as cool as it was, just was kind of a, don't you think, kind of a dud? It wasn't, it felt slow. It wasn't it overheated. It just felt like a dud. And this feels so much better. And I guess it's the size?
Yeah. That's the original Air. I think Apple has these products that I've always said are their public R&D. Things like the Cube, I always feel, was like public R&D for the Mac Mini.
I had one of those.
And the first Air was sort of like, let's just see if we can do this. Let's figure out the engineering. Mm. Let's put it out there for the high-end users and then get a lot of great feedback and then really womp them with the next great version.
By the way, somebody's saying in the chat room, and this is true, if you want to become as big as Exxon in revenue, you do the service that the NFC on the cell phones on the iPhone, the near-field communications, you are the service. You don't go through Visa. You do it, and you take 30% of every whatever. And you could be as big as Exxon, too.
Actually, I was chatting with Paul in the car on the way up, and he was saying that there's a possibility of Apple becoming a bank because of, they're actually...
Right.
Yeah.
They got the cash. They got the cash.
I thought I've decided that the best way to handle net neutrality is for Apple, Google, Netflix, and Amazon to just invest billions of dollars into a new company that just builds their own service. We'll show AT&T and Verizon. You know, so you take a bunch of the guys who need to have that open platform.
Google came very close to doing that when they were bidding for that 700 megahertz spectrum. They could have, had they bought it, it was going to be very expensive. But they had the money.
If you built a new company with the companies that need, you know, the companies that need that to be opened, and you just let that, they'd have the money to run, you know, and they wouldn't have to, they wouldn't be caught up with all the old technologies and so on and so forth.
Am I wrong? Isn't billion, okay, now the chat room's making me nuts. Isn't billion different in the UK? It's 1,000. Maybe I'm wrong. I thought a billion meant something different.
No, I'm not sure.
It's one and nine zeros.
There is a slight difference.
I thought there was a difference. I thought a billion is 1,000 millions. I don't know.
That's what it is here. That's what it is. A billion is a billion.
All right. Oh, UK doesn't do that anymore.
Do we not?
Apparently not.
Okay.
So when Don was growing up, a billion was a lot more. Now it's
because no one had it. So yeah, billion was just like it was unobtainium.
A billion in the U.S. is 1,000 million. In the U.K., I think it used to be a million million.
Okay,
which is a lot. Mm. I'll take it. There's a Crucial Wax says there's a short and long scale. I'm so sorry. Wow. Oh, it's France that it's different. In France, it's a billion here, a billion there. Who cares? Let us take a break. Come back. Alex Lindsay is here from the Pixel Core, pixelcore.com, for the Guild of Multimedia Artists, who are learning and working together, soon to have a beautiful studio in Petaluma.
I can't wait.
From the UK, visiting us from Liverpool, Don and his lovely wife at MacWorld in San Francisco, and then you're going to head on to...
to MacMania 11.
MacMania 11.
Yeah.
That's going to be so cool.
Yeah, yeah.
I am bringing... Okay, I just want you to know... I'm going to bring Settlers. I can't get my family to play Settlers of Catan with me. This is a board game. You're going to have to play with me. YouTube both.
Great game.
Yeah. It's like the new golf in Silicon Valley.
Yeah.
Because they don't want to walk around so much. So it's a board game, and I'm going to bring a cribbage set. So I will be sitting every evening in the lounge after dinner with a cribbage and Settlers of Catan. And
playing both at the same time?
Yeah, because it's boring if you just play one game at a time. And my iPad, so I can farm.
My kids and I play Scrabble constantly.
Scrabble's fun.
It's like the family.
I wouldn't mind playing a little Scrabble, too.
It's great on the iPad. It's actually better on the iPad than it is on a board.
I'm a Word with Friends guy, though. You're a Scrabble guy.
I'm a Scrabble guy.
Yeah, I like Words with Friends. Also here, Mr. Adam Christiansen. And I got it right now. MacCast.com.
Yep.
Andy landed. So he never did get on, because I looked.
Oh, yeah. He couldn't get on.
So Eileen's... He's going to try on his phone. All right.
Yeah. He's taxiing right now.
Apparently, he can tweet and text, but not Skype. Before we go any further, I should, you know, this is really what Andy should be doing. He should be using GoToMeeting. He could do that from Virgin America. He could actually get to his computer with GoToMeeting. Remote access done right, Mac or PC. You can access a PC from a Mac and back. And vice versa. If your business is like most businesses these days, I know you want to cut costs. I know you want to save money. You want to improve workflow, and you don't want to travel so much. You want to make meetings more effective. That's why web conferencing is really becoming hot, and GoToMeeting is the way to do it. You cut costs by reducing travel, not to mention the stress you save. You'll improve communications with everybody you work with, and you'll work smarter. You'll be more efficient. GoToMeeting is the best. Why? Because it's fast. It's easy. It's secure. Never been an exploit with GoToMeeting. I can't say that for anybody else. And it's so simple to use. You know, the people you're meeting with don't have to have it pre-installed. If you go right now to GoToMeeting.com/MacBreak, you can try it free for 30 days. You'll have it ready. And the next time you're on a conference call and it's starting to lag, say, let me show you this.
Well, and all the tools that you have of being able to interact, we use it all the time.
There's chat, being able to chat,
people can raise their hand, you can go back and forth, we can show them stuff on the screen, and it's just completely changed how we, you know, work with our members.
Yeah,
great.
Try it free. Just don't, you know. I like it when our advertisers have free trials, and so here's your chance. Go to GoToMeeting.com/MacBreak. GoToMeeting.com/MacBreak. Sign up. You'll get the first 30 days free. It does include phone and voice over IP conferencing for free for 30 days. I think it's $49 a month after the first month. So it's still very affordable, and you will save a lot of time. Go to meeting.com/MacBreak. We thank them. A tip of the hat. We salute you. A MacBreak, we salute you. Go to meeting.com/MacBreak. In Norwegian, a billion is a trillion.
Why can't we all just get along?
I tell you. Thank you. Kyle, thank you for explaining all of this to me in our chat room. Let's see. Moving along here. Playboy, yay. Hugh Hefner got everybody all a dither, by saying, hey, Playboy will be on the iPad. And we thought maybe Steve has relaxed the rules. No.
No.
It's a web app. Playboy, he said in his tweet. By the way, you know, you really should be following Hugh Hefner's tweets. He tweets in his bathrobe and jammies. He says, Playboy will be available on iPad without the Playmates. Steve Jobs says a thing about nudity. I thought that was funny. Yeah, I read it for the articles.
Well, now
yeah.
You can really say you read it for the articles.
Yeah, sure. Actually, it will be uncensored, but it will be an app, a web-based subscription. They're using Bondi Digital Publishing to give users access to every issue of Playboy, past and present. And yes, you will be able to pinch. Nothing more to say about that, hey?
No.
Well,
the web app thing, I'll say something on the web app thing, because we just started a San Diego iOS user group here in our area, and the guy that runs it is really into the web app thing, which Apple kind of moved on from, but you can sign up on Apple's website to be a web developer, Safari mobile developer, right? And you can really build full-featured apps, and they have what's called a manifest document, and you can put all your assets in there, and you can have it downloaded and updated.
Interesting. So there is a download to the machine that it will do.
Yeah, so you can set it up in a way where it essentially installs on the phone like a true app, and he even showed me he can put it in his app in airplane mode and run the entire thing without a connection. And then if he pushes an update to his website, the next time you do have a connection, it'll pull down new assets and new updates.
I actually like that. I think I did not realize that. I think that maybe is an underused tool.
Well, and it gives you, I think it gives you a lot of flexibility, especially if you're building for a company.
Do you do that?
We're experimenting with a lot of different ways of doing it. But we're looking at stuff that we want to use as general communication tools in the Pixel Core as we start to experiment with a lot of the stuff is, I don't want to put it on the iTunes store. I'm not ready to make it public. But it's going to move information around, and it's enough, to do that. And I think if you're a school, if you're a corporation, if you're, there's a bunch of enterprise level stuff where you're not trying to sell it, but you also want to update it quickly and have control over it. I think it makes a lot of sense.
I have to look at that more. Can you use something like Scribd to create kind of the beginnings of your HTML5 app?
Never tried that. I don't know.
Because they have like that generating thing. Okay. Mac was 27 yesterday. Happy birthday. Oh, I can't sing that. I'll have to owe money to Time Warner AOL.
You have to pay it. Yeah, royalty.
How many notes? That was two notes. I think I'm safe.
$4,000.
The next note was going to be two. Yeah. 27 years old. So we were just talking to Paul Kent. He said that the MacWorld Expo was 27. I mean, that's kind of cool. It was January. I forgot it was January. And if you bought within the first 100 days, then you were like something special.
I think my cousin got one when...
I'm a 100-day. I'm a 100-day guy.
I wasn't. I had an Apple II, and it took so much work to get my dad to buy the Apple II that I wasn't going to get a Mac.
From YouTube, our third YouTube video of the day. This is Steve Jobs demonstrating the Macintosh 27 years ago.
You've just seen some pictures of Macintosh. Now I'd like to show you Macintosh in person.
It sure was cute back then.
All of the images you are about to see on the large screen will be generated by what's in that bag.
No! This was the original 128K Mac, one floppy, 400K floppy. So all the programs had to fit in 400K. If you had more... Oh, look, that's the famous Mac bag. Remember that bag? Oh, there it is. It was the first time we saw a Macintosh. He did this, I think, in Cupertino, didn't he? In front of mostly Apple audience. So they were very excited. They've come a long way in their videography. He's actually plugging it in.
Look how formal he is.
He's got a double-breasted suit and a bow tie. Look, there's the floppy. 400K floppy. He's going to boot. That's pretty cool. I don't know how they got it to boot that fast.
I was going to say, I was quite impressed that there's no smoke and mirrors because if he's actually plugging
it in. He plugged it in, yeah. Well, this is a very early prototype. For all we know, this is all in firmware. And the floppy was... But remember, this is a bitmap display. Nobody had seen anything like this in 1984. We were still looking at green screen on black. The word Macintosh is smoothly scrolling across the screen. You hear the audience go crazy. First time I saw this, I thought, this is odd. And then I realized, oh, they're all Apple employees. And then it's drawing insanely great under the words Macintosh.
Boy, that's superlative. You're 27 years old.
Even then.
Not magic yet. Just insane.
That was a Steve. There's a Mac Paint. Bill Atkinson's program. Amazing, really. Mac Write. You could only run one of these at a time because each had its own floppy, and if you wanted to copy data, you had to swap floppies like 800 times. There's a certificate in celebration of Macintosh. January 24th, 1984.
Fonts. Proportionally spaced fonts.
It's hard to remember how remarkable this was at the time, but it really was. There's the programming language in Pascal in the early days. It's not the Olympics, that's Chariots of Fire, which is an odd choice, but I'm probably going to have to... Oh, Alice, that was fun. Remember that game? It was like a weird chess game.
Now, we've done a lot of talking about Macintosh recently, but today, for the first time ever, I'd like to let Macintosh speak for itself.
He must have been pretty happy at this point.
Hello, I'm Macintosh. It sure is great to get out of that bag. Unaccustomed as I am to public speaking, I'd like to share with you a maxim I thought of the first time I met an IBM mainframe. Never trust a computer you can't switch.
Well, the audience is going crazy.
But right now, I'd like to sit back and listen. So it is with considerable pride that I introduce a man who's been like a father to me, Steve Jobs.
27 years ago, kind of hard to believe, isn't it? It was a good moment, though, I have to say. Just thought I'd replay that. Did you get chills?
I just remember being very sad. I was watching it and just going... No, I didn't. I saw it later. I mean, I think I was playing on Macintosh.
I saw it.
I didn't see it live.
And I went to Macy's with my credit card in hand, $25 poorer. I had one of those suckers. I've had every Mac ever since, by the way. I don't think
when did they start selling them at Sears?
Probably close to that time.
Yeah. It was, you could walk into Sears and buy a Mac at Sears. Screwdriver and a Macintosh.
Amazing. It is time for our picks of the week. And I will start with Alex Lindsay because he's got his sitting right in front of him.
No, this is not a pick.
It's not a pick?
It's not a pick for a Mac show.
It's a 3D Panasonic 3D camera.
Panasonic 3D camera.
You saw that at CES and now you already have one?
Well, they're lending me one to shoot stuff at MacWorld. So I'm going to be talking about this a lot, both at MacWorld and at the Super Meet. There's a Final Cut Pro Super Meet on Friday night. And I'll be showing a lot more of this. And we're going to be posting some of this video on YouTube soon. We're going to be doing a bunch of tests with it. And so we're doing lots of testing with it, but it's called a 3D A1, and it is awesome. It's not really a Mac pick, but it's a really cool camera. That's all I have to say. So
you can't edit that in Final Cut.
Yeah, you can.
Oh, there's a plugin.
There's a plugin to view it, but what you do is you can simply stack the stuff up and edit the left eye, and then you can worry about exporting it later. So it's actually totally.
So if you edit the left eye, you're not going to see the depth, but you're going to at least edit it.
You can edit the content, and then you can play with the depth. And we have our new conduit that's going to be coming out soon allows you to actually composite in real time in 3D, which is one of the reasons we're testing it right now. So anyway, we're having lots of fun with that. But you need a place to view stuff like this. And so that's actually one of my picks for today is it's by Luxology, and it's called Luxfolio. So if you want to see some 3D on your iPad, now you need the red and blue glasses, or you need some kind of glasses, you know, to see it in full 3D. But Luxfolio is just a great way for you to view, stuff. And they've got a bunch of great sample files in it. And it's a great way to show off stuff. I know that I've had trouble where I have to convert everything that I'm shooting that's 3D into something so that I can put them in iPhoto and then I can show them to people. This will take the actual 3D pictures themselves. And
this
I have a couple.
Is an iPad app?
It's an iPad app. In fact, you'll see some here. Zebras from Rwanda and Dinner in Paris by Alex Lindsay in their sample files.
Oh, that's nice.
So I sent them. Well, as soon as they posted it, I was like, this is really cool. Do you want some more images? And they were like, sure. And I sent them like a whole pile of them. They were like, we'll take these two. So
So these are the ones you took with the W1 and W2? Or?
Yeah, the W3. And
W1.
These are both W1 photos. I hadn't got the W3 yet. But so W1.
That's the Fujitsu dual
the Fuji
dual lens 3D,
which is like the tiny version of
camera.
This guy. It does still with
camera.
Some video, and okay. This does lots of big video. And by the way, this is like the first real like production camera that you can use. That's easy to like. It's not like a big pile of wires and cameras all wired together. It's like the non geek. Like I just push a button and start recording in 3D.
Right.
So the anyway, but if you want to view stuff in 3D, there's the and we're gonna be talking about. I'm gonna be launching a 3D podcast soon. So we're digging deep into that because I'm just having so much fun
You're
with
the
it.
First to do a 1080p podcast, and now that
we're gonna do a MacBreak.
He likes doing podcasts nobody can watch. It'll be Anaglyph.
We're gonna do an Anaglyph MacBreak. We should be releasing it in the next week or two. So with this camera, so we'll have some fun with that. And one of the things we're gonna be talking about a little bit is also my pick for my Mac pick. I always want to make sure that I'm still picking Mac programs.
Yeah, it's hard to do, isn't it?
It is, but there are some great programs out there, and one of the ones that I've been using a lot, and I wanted to really make sure that I was testing. I don't think that I picked it, so I realized I was looking through. I think it's been on the list of picking is Wirecast. I think I've talked about Wirecast.
Oh, I'm sure we've picked it, but I'll pick it
the
again.
The new one, though, is way better. So I think I picked Wirecast in the past, one of the older versions, but Wirecast 4.0 is super stable, and I'm running... I've run four HDMI out of little like HV40s or HS21s and I'm editing, you know, so HD. I've got it set up where Wirecast will look at, you can have desktop presenters, so you know, like all of these computers. You can have like 10 computers in the office and tell Wirecast, as soon as you launch their little desktop presenter, they all just show up as cameras that you can edit from. Mm-hmm. And then it has all the streaming built into it. So we use it a lot as just a raw streaming. You know, and a lot of people just use it like, I'm just going to pipe video into it and stream, but it does editing. It does a lot of other things. You can do lower thirds. You can do, and the new pro version lets you put in digital sets and, you know, lots of other stuff into it. And so it took me a little, you know, I wanted to make sure that it was as solid as the older one was a little flaky at times. It was still really useful, but this 4.0 I've been banging on. I use it every week for the Pixel Core streams as my test. We have a lot of hardware mixers as well. But I'm just really, really enjoying using it. Are you using
it? Whenever I've done live stuff, I've used Wirecast, and there's a slight learning curve to get into it. But once you've got past that, it's a fantastic program. And I do like the way they built in the streaming capabilities as well. So
and it's so easy. Streaming, recorded disc, all that stuff is all built in. And you can stream to, you know, like I've on my Mac Pro, I've done up to 6 streams to different locations at different compression rates. And it just kind of clunks along, you know. So it's if you have the bandwidth, it's good. So those are my picks.
Well, look who the dog dragged in, ladies and gentlemen. he's at the airport. he's going. I know exactly where he is too. Is at the international terminal. He's going down the conveyor belt on his way to baggage claim at SFO. Hello, Andy Yannacco.
I'm traveling 100% carry on today, sirs. I'm not getting paid enough for to actually check bags, not this economy.
Well, it's great to see you. Thank you for making it today.
Yeah, I'm just sad that we weren't able to make this an in-flight experience.
Yeah, I've done a. I remember when Chris DeBona for the first time had Wi-Fi in a plane many years ago. He made a Skype call, but I don't think really Virgin Atlantic Wi-Fi is quite up to Skype.
Yeah, I think it's mostly for downloading photos of the kids rather than doing Skype chats with your mistress. So this is officially the hat trick, though. This is 3 weeks in a row in which, due to circumstances beyond my effective control, I've had to at least make a token appearance via the mobile version of iPhone. So I think of Skype app.
We do miss you, but we're glad you're coming into town for MacWorld, and we look forward to seeing you on Thursday. Everybody, are you doing some sessions at MacWorld?
Yeah, I'm doing a session at 3:30 on Thursday. Basically, it's about using your iPad as the only notebook computer you ever need. It's called Business Travel on One iPad a Day. So that's my one big thing. I'm also doing a panel sometime around 3 o'clock Saturday afternoon with Joe Holmes and Chris Green and a whole bunch of other people who used to get together back when MacWorld Expo was Anatevka, and we were all just little residents of the shtetl, fearing the incursions of the Tsar.
Did you want to do your? I know you're. I mean, look, you're walking down the conveyor belt here. But do you want to do your pick?
Well, okay. I'm gonna have to swallow my pride a little bit and say that my pick of the week really does have to be Skype Mobile, because after all the complaining that I've done about Skype in the past and certainly in the future, I'm not giving up my right to complain about Skype in the future. The fact of the matter is that they've written a very, very slick app for the iPhone that, when you find yourself in the middle of the air, when MacBreak Weekly happens, or when you find yourself in the middle of your car because your internet connection has dropped out, you still have a perfectly good Skype video client.
I mean, look at this. This is how he's talking to us right now. It's via his iPhone.
It's like just a CNN, and I'm in a war zone.
It's actually a little better than that. There's less latency. The picture's pretty good, and the audio's excellent. Right.
Also, I'm on another moving walkway, so I can do a Jamiroquai video.
Yeah, no, it's very nice. It's a crane shot. I like it.
Exactly.
Dolly shot, I should say, yeah. And now, Andy Anatko with the dolly shot. Yeah. Oh, no, watch out behind you. No. Andy, we'll let you go. We'll look forward to seeing you at MacWorld Expo. Everybody should go to CWOB.com, Andy's website, and, of course, read him in the Chicago Sun-Times. Roger Ebert has been tweeting a lot of your stuff. I guess you like that Nikon P7000. Uh-oh, we lost it.
Yep, I
pushed it just a little too far. It was so close. If I just hung up on him. We're losing you now, Andy, but we'll talk about that next time.
Next time we speak, I'll be far less pixelated than I am right now.
Actually, you look great. Thank you. Andy Anatko on his way to MacWorld Expo. He's coming.
Bye.
See you, Andy. He looks like kind of like an Amish guy in that shot, with the mutton chops and the hat. I think Skype Mobile is a good pick. It's really pretty cool, and it's a little more usable than FaceTime because he was using it on 3G.
I'd say it's actually a lot more usable than FaceTime.
Mr. Don McAllister, your pick of the week.
My pick. Okay. Well, I'll do two. Going from what I said.
Oh, boy, we're all going to do two now, aren't we?
We should do a Mac one and an iPhone.
All right, I'm going to do that, too. I'll do it, too. Go ahead.
The Mac one really is probably one we've done before, which is Pixelmator. And the reason I've picked Pixelmator...
Wow, I saw those numbers.
Yeah, they've just announced they've sold $1 million worth of software in the first 20 days of the Mac App Store.
Truly amazing. Pixelmator.
There have been a lot of developers that are talking about how much more they're selling on the Mac App Store.
Mm, you know, on the one hand, I'm thrilled. On the other hand, this is what I was worried about, is that the App Store was going to be such a compelling experience, both for users and developers, that it would push all other forms of app
sales. We're going to be talking about this at MacWorld on Saturday. Okay. Aaron Hillegas and I and a couple other folks.
I mean, it was one of the featured apps on the front of the App Store from day one, I think, so that's probably given a huge boost. But still, $1 million worth of business.
That's a lot, and I think they're probably not the only one. And Pixelmator is a really good example because they've been around for a long time. They've always been a great program. They've been a pick of the week many times on MacBreak Weekly. But because you didn't know where to find it, you didn't kind of remember maybe the name or whatever, it just was hard to find. And it's right there. In fact, it's not even the number one top-grossing app. I see Aperture, iPhoto, and Pages, all Apple apps are bigger than Pixelmator. It's only $30, which was less than it was. Yeah. You know, they've been in a lot of bundles. They do the Mac Heist every year, but this was big for them. I'm happy for them.
Okay, so I just thought I'd throw that in the mix. But my main pick for this week is an iPhone app. One called Glimpse. I don't know if you've had a play with
Glimpse. I love Glimpse.
Fantastic. As a concerned parent with a young teenage daughter, and more often than not, you know, I don't want to keep tabs on her all the time, but it's sometimes nice if she's leaving somewhere, going somewhere else, that she lets me know where she is and I can, you know, make sure she gets there. Okay. Well, with Glimpse, basically, there's an iPhone app that it's a free service as well. She just sends me a glimpse and makes it active for, say, half an hour. And within that half an hour, I can actually on my iPhone see exactly where she is and where she's going to and sort of track it in real time. And it's fantastic for, you know, for parents and stuff, but even just going to meetings or anything like that.
If you're late for a meeting, I've used it. We were late for a Google meeting, and it's just great.
It's fantastic. It works superbly.
Yeah. It's free. Mm-hmm. The first time I saw it as Scoble was late to Twit, and he sent us a glimpse, and we actually watched him.
Oh, right.
And we knew when he got here. Mm-hmm. It's just really cool.
Yeah, but she broke down a couple of days ago and sent me a glimpse so I could find out where her location was. And she could actually, the good thing was she could actually see where I was as well. So I could see where she was and she could see where I was. And we can, you know.
Kind of Marco Polo.
Yeah.
It's kind of amazing, really.
Because once you get within 50 feet, now you can hopefully see each other.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's just remarkable. GLYMPSE. It's free on the iPhone. It's Android as well. And it's cross-platform, so that's kind of neat. And it uses Google Maps. I have used it, too. I think it's an excellent suggestion. Let us head to Mr. Christiansen, who's flying out tonight to MacWorld.
Yep. Tomorrow. Yeah, I'll actually be there tomorrow. But, I guess if we have to do two, I was going to do an iPad app. I'm a web developer also, kind of in my second job outside of podcasting. And I've been looking for a really good editor on the iPad. And I don't know that it's all the way there yet, but Textastic. Have any of you used this?
No, I haven't seen it. I've tried some other ones.
Yeah, the big thing for me with Textastic was it's just a simple, straightforward editor. I'm really looking for something that's going to mimic a lot of what TextMate does for me on the desktop. Mm-hmm. So it has 80 different types, support for 80 different languages with the code highlighting. So that was a big one for me. Mm. It's nice and fast. It adds a little extra row to the on-screen keyboard with the relevant characters, so brackets and things like that you have instant access to. And the one thing that was really missing that they just added with the latest update was integrated FTP and Dropbox support. So that's in there. About the only
that's
thing,
key. If you got Dropbox, you got it. It's done. You're done as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah, about the only thing left, and it will let you preview HTML, so you can get live preview of HTML.
Oh, wow.
The only thing I wish it had now, the one last thing, and hopefully they have plans to add this, would be code completion. But that might be asking a little bit much out of an iPad app. But yeah, so Textastic.
Can you actually code? Do you actually code in this?
I'm trying to. Like I said, I'm playing around with it. You know, I haven't found the perfect thing yet.
Yeah.
It's still easier on the desktop. Oh, it does have full support for Bluetooth keyboards and connected keyboards. So I haven't tried doing it with a keyboard, but I could take my Bluetooth keyboard and this out, you know, to a coffee shop and probably get some pretty significant amount of work done, especially with the code highlighting. I do a lot of PHP development and CSS and things like that, and it supports both of those very, very nicely.
Even if we're just like looking at code, it's nice to have that highlighting, that syntax highlighting.
Yeah. And since we are doing a Mac app, I'll do a really simple one. I'm not a huge weather person, but there is a weather app on the new Mac App Store called Swacket, which stands for sweater, coat, or jacket. Swacket.com, Swacket.com. And what's really neat about it is it's just a big, large interface. And when you open it up and you've got your location in there, it gives you these little simple line illustrations, vector art illustrations of a man and a woman and the appropriate clothing for the type of weather that's happening that day. And it's free right now, and they're going to have, it looks like, add-on packs that you can buy different characters.
That's hysterical.
So they have like a British invasion pack, and you'll be able
to get
a
bunch
of guys.
I see the Fab Four on the left there. Yeah.
Yeah, I was wondering whether it was going to be location-specific, because in L.A. it would be black, and then the other one would be black, and then the other one would be black.
It's a really pretty little weather app, and it's simple and it's free, so.
You know, as long as you're mentioning that, I don't know if they've solved this, but somebody stole the, remember, there's a great weather app on the iPad that is HD, Weather HD, and somebody made the same name on the App Store, but it's not the same app, it's not as good, yeah, it's still there, it's got a 1-star rating because it's such a crappy app. I think a lot of people bought it thinking it was Weather HD, the same one we see on the iPhone and the iPad. It is not.
Right, there's name squatting. This happened, if you remember, this happened to a lot of Macintosh developers when the App Store came out.
Right.
the iPhone App Store. People started making iPhone versions of apps with the same names, but they weren't the same ones from the Mac desktop.
Now it's going the other way. Apple's done nothing about it. But fortunately, if you read the reviews, it's very clear. Look at that. One star, and everybody says, not the real Weather HD. In fact, this one from the actual developer of Weather HD, he said, the developer misappropriately used our name in selling this application. Has nothing to do with us, the creators of the original. And I would like to see Weather HD on the App Store. Actually, I love it on the iPad. It's really pretty. Do not buy. Imposter. You know? That's interesting. Fool me once. Why would I want the, you know? Unfortunately, I think it also damages these guys who create Weather HD for the iPad, because inevitably a lot of people think it's the same thing. And this one's not so hot. Thank you, Adam. Two apps. I guess it's up to me to do two apps as well. Oh, man. You guys.
Up in the bar.
You guys is up in the bar. Well, I'm going to do, let's start with the Mac app. I actually wanted to do a piece of hardware. I'll do that in a second, but I'll do the Mac app as well. And it's just a silly little app, but I actually really like it. It's called Drop Copy. You know that app? It's by 10BaseT Interactive. And the idea is it adds a drop zone to your screen. And you just it's like a little vortex. You drag a file over to it, and it copies it over your LAN to another system. And it actually is kind of makes it very simple. It sees the other systems that are running Drop Copy. It'll give you a list of systems that are available, and you just drop stuff into it. It couldn't be simpler to use. Let me move my my screens over, and I can show it to you. It's just right there. There's a little, you can't even really see. It's just a little zone there, that little circle. And if I drag something over to the zone, it's going to, actually, I think it's copying it over the internet. Yeah, it's copying it to my computer in the other, at home. And there it goes. Whoosh. Makes a little whoosh sound at the end, I think. So that's called Drop Copy. I'm not sure how much it is because it's installed. I don't think it's very expensive. And then this is the, let's see, I'm going to pull up a camera here. This is the physical thing I was going to show you. Let's see. That's you, Don. Let's see. Oh, you're on camera 5, so I have to hold it up like this. Let's see. Where's Don? There it is. There it is. Look at that, Don. This is from... Now, Don, in fact, hold up your Mophie, because you've got a Mophie case. And we've recommended the Mophie before, and I love the Mophie. This is a second battery for the iPhone 4. This is similar. It's a little thinner. If you turn your Mophie on its side, it's not as pretty. It doesn't have that silver bezel. This is a little smaller. It's also not quite the big battery. But what I like about it, this is from Techion. It's $79, a little cheaper than the Mophie. It has replaceable batteries. So you can buy extra ones of these for $40 or $50, charge them up, and then just plug them in. So you can have 3 or 4 snap-in battery packs that'll give you not a full charge on your iPhone, but close to it. It has an on-off switch. It is the mini USB. It will sync over mini USB, so you can charge and sync when it's on. But I just like the idea that you can buy additional little battery units for your trip, wherever you're going. I bought 2.
Because the Mophie has the top.
Yeah, the Mophie has something similar. Yeah, but that's the battery. So they've got it much more compact on this. It's Techion.
And the 2 is really important because it means you have one in charge and one on the phone.
Exactly.
You pop it out and swap it.
Exactly. That's how I plan to use it. T-E-K-K. Okay, I have to do this again.
There's too many people in here.
T-E-K-K-E-O-N.com. They call it the iPhone Power. Now, I ended up buying 2 cases because they're sold out of the little battery units, and I wanted to have this for Mac Mania 11. But you'll be able to buy a number of them. And it's small, and it's a little bit more compact than the Mophie. And they do come in colors. So you can get red, white, or black. I bought black so that you wouldn't really know there was anything on there. T-E-K-K-E-O-N.com. It's very cool. That's it for the show. Thank you, Adam Christiansen, for joining us. Have a safe trip out to San Francisco from MacWorld. We'll see you at MacWorld Expo day after tomorrow.
Yep, thank you. Looking forward to it. I can't wait to get up there and see everybody.
You're going
to
do MacCast from there?
Yeah, I run around the show floor. I try and capture the things for my listeners who aren't able to make the show. So I've asked people to send me in and say, you know, what do you want to see? Who do you want me to talk to? So we go around to do interviews, and then I'll put those up on the feed at maccast.com.
That's cool. It's like a request podcast.
Yeah. I've always tried to make it real community based. My show. That's kind of my angle on it is the virtual user group feel. So,
and you and Don are on the Mac Roundtable. How often do you guys do that?
It's once every 2 weeks, ostensibly. So twice a month we try to go.
Yeah.
But we're doing a live one at MacWorld. Yep. So we'll be at the...
Oh, good.
You need to just double check when it is, but here we go. You can look it at the MacWorld Expo website. It'll tell you. But if I can find it quickly, I shall tell you when it is.
While he's looking at that, I should also mention, you know, every year for a while, I've been doing just the podcast New Media Meetup, and Paul Kent gave us a space a couple years ago to do that. So that's one of the birds of a feather sessions.
Oh, good. You're going to do that again. Oh, good.
When is that?
Yeah. It's Thursday, the 27th, from 5:30 to 6. So it sometimes gets a little difficult for people to get there. But it's a lot of fun. We just talk about podcasting and new media. And people have questions, you know, whether you're a listener or you're a producer. It's good for both. The birds of a feather, if anybody doesn't know, it hasn't been a MacWorld. They're real casual, just sessions. There's no central speaker. I'm just kind of moderating or guiding the discussion, really. And we just chat back and forth. So it's a lot of fun.
I will try to make it. I'm doing something kind of weird at MacWorld. We're going to do iPad today, 1:30 to 3 thereabouts. We're going to run around with our live streaming unit, so we will stream that here at live.twit.tv. And then give you an iPad Today show that we'll edit out of that. And then after that, I'm going over to David Prager's house for the Dig Dialogue. This is where the folks at Dig, ask questions of somebody. And they're going to interview the CEO of Dig. And they thought, well, we shouldn't probably have anybody in-house do that. They don't want to get fired. So they asked me. So I'm very flattered. And I'll be doing that, interviewing the new CEO of Dig on the Dig Dialogue. That'll be... not live, but they'll edit that up. But that's supposed to be like 4:30 to 6:30. But if I can, Adam, I would really like to get to that podcaster roundtable because that's fun. That's really fun. Yeah.
You know what I'm noticing is I think the Mac Roundtable podcast is right at the same time.
Oh, yeah. Caramba.
So it'll be interesting. 5:15 to 6, it looks like, on Thursday the MacWorld Live stage, which I think is in the show floor. Right, Don?
Yeah, that's the one. That's the one.
So... I think plug-alicious right there. We've got about 18 plugs. Thank you, Adam, for being here. It's always
Thank
a pleasure.
You.
And we'll see you in San Francisco in a couple of days. Yep. We're already seeing Don McAllister in the Bay Area. He came out early. Screencasts Online is where you can find Don online, mm-hmm. as well as, of course, the Roundtable and other places.
Yep.
Anything you want to plug?
Well, there's still the 50% discount for any MacBreak Weekly
That's a good
listeners
plug.
And viewers that want to join Screencast Online, check out some of my stuff.
I'm liking that.
So I've sort of kept that in place anyway. So
thank you. What do? They just go to Screencast Online?
Is there to screencastonline.com/extra. You can learn all about the benefits of being a member.
Cool.
And use MacBreak Weekly as the coupon code if you want to sign up. Some free stuff over there as well, but the good stuff is all the premium content.
Yeah. I like the way you do that, the freemium. Model mm-hmm. and that's worked very well for you, which is really neat.
I've had a slight change over the past couple of months. I've moved from a weekly show to a fortnightly show, so they're now double length and they're slightly more in depth as well. And they seem to
people like that.
People do like that, yeah.
Yeah, it's always been my experience, but nobody bothers. It doesn't bother anybody if it's longer. They want the facts, the detail. People love that information. Yeah. Thank you, Don. Screencastonline.com/extra, and don't forget to use the code MacBreak Weekly to save a little bit of money on your membership. Alex Lindsay of the Pixel Core is going to be big time at MacWorld this week.
Boy. I'm talking about Future of Video. Tomorrow is one of their special conferences, tomorrow afternoon. And then it's going on all day. And then I'm going to be at the Drobo booth talking about storage on Thursday at 1. And then then on Friday, I'm going to be at the Final Cut user group talking about 3D. And then on Saturday, we'll be talking about iOS versus OS X in Saturday afternoon. And then all during that, we're going to be streaming some 3D, some live, wandering around. We're going to be lots of streaming. People should follow either Pixelcore or Alex Lindsay on Twitter, because what we'll do is we'll constantly be twittering like, hey, we're doing live now, or hey, we're doing 3D streams, or hey, we're doing, something like that. So definitely go up to just follow Alex Lindsay, it's all one word, or Pixelcore, or both, because I might forget every once in a while. And Carolyn will be, our producer, will be actually posting that stuff. But it's a good place to go for that, and we'll be updating it there. It's the easiest place for us to update is just on Twitter.
Just follow him on Twitter, yeah.
Yep.
I forgot to say.
And I apologize in advance. If you don't want to hear me spout off about stupid things, follow Pixelcore. It will just tell you what's going on. If you follow me, I am not a business Twitterer. Mm-hmm. I'm like a whatever I think is marginally humorous Twitterer. And sometimes...
And He's a Steelers fan.
And I'm a big Steelers fan. So during Steeler games, I will tell you that you will get five or six half-drunken Twitters while I'm drinking beer and complaining about
the
refs.
You're pretty happy. I was very happy for you.
It was a good day. It was a good day. It was a good day. That's all I got to say. It was almost turned into a bad day.
It was exciting.
It was a great day. And then the Steelers do this to us on purpose. I swear that they do some kind of like get adrenaline to attach us more to the team because it's never a blowout. And neither will the Super Bowl. It'll be close. It'll be down to the last 2 minutes.
I like close games. Everybody likes close games.
I just want them to blow out. Once I just went 35-10. Just once.
Sorry. Thank you, everybody, for being here. We are having a meetup. If you're coming to MacWorld Expo, as I said, we'll be doing iPad today, 6:30 on. I think it's nominally 6:30 to 8:30, but, you know, we'll stay there as long as we have to and can. At the Intercontinental Hotel, which is just around the corner from Moscone Center. Easy to get to. You'll find it very quickly. And we're in the first floor bar, bar 888, starting at 6:30. I'll be there. Sarah Lane, Tom Merritt, Eileen.
I'll be there.
Alex, Lindsay, Don, I hope you'll... It's Thursday.
Thursday.
You're probably booked. When everything is. Everybody's doing it Thursday. After the round table, come on over. Come on over. We'd love to see you. You too, Adam.
Great.
Drinks are on me, gentlemen. Not an open bar. Just these guys. Oh, I'll buy you a drink too if you come by and say hi. What should be the secret code? I like Android.
That would be a secret code in Apple.
That would be really hard to get people to say. All right, we'll see y'all. That'd be fun. Intercontinental Hotel Bar 888, 6:30 to 8:30 on the 27th.
It's a great bar.
Yep. Thank you for joining us. Sorry about the sudden change in schedule. I hope that that didn't throw anybody. We do this show normally 11 a.m. Pacific time, 2 p.m. Eastern time at live.twit.tv. That's I believe 1800 UTC. It's plus 7 now. We went back to plus 7 for UTC because they don't do daylight. I don't know. Something like that. At live. Just, turn on live.twit.tv when you wake up and leave it on all day. And then when you go to bed, you can turn it off. That's it. And you'll see us and everything else that we do. I will not be here next week. Will you take the reins?
It's either Andy or not. Andy or I.
Okay. Because Don and I are going off together.
Yes. I think I did the last one. I think it's going to be Andy's turn if he's available.
All right. That's cool. Looking forward to Mac Mania 11. If you're on the cruise, we can't wait to see you. That's going to be fun. And, I bet you, if you went to insidecruises.com, it's kind of late to promote this. If you have 12 days free.
You'd highly suggest it.
Oh, it's going to be a blast. I think Waz is going to be on it with us. At last I heard. Yeah. Sal Segoyan.
Sal's going to be
Don,
there.
Me.
That's a party.
It's going to be fun. Mm. It's going to be a lot of
fun. I'm jealous.
Insidecruises.com. And, if you can't go to this one, there'll be another one.
Yep.
Only
2 a year.
And another one. Thanks, everybody, for joining us. Have a great week. Enjoy MacWorld Expo if you get to go. Otherwise, watch the coverage on Pixel Core and Twit, because we're going to wall-to-wall it. Now you better get back to work because, break time's over. See ya.